Nou, welkom allemaal. Ik hoop dat jullie niet te veel last hebben van de after dinner dip.
Ik ga het Engels doen.
Oh ja, Engels? Oké, shit. Let's do it in English. My name is Gerben Uitenbulten. I work for one of the smallest companies in the world. It's called Accenture. It has like 430,000 people. However, I'm part of what we call the Liquid Studio. And the Liquid Studio is like a mini startup within the giant Accenture ecosystems. But I'm not here to promote Accenture or Liquid Studio or anything like that. I'm here about to talk about Ingenico and what we've done together with Roy there as well. Who of you have ever heard about Ingenico? I just see a few names. So I think, Roy, that's for you to explain what the hell Ingenico is.
Exactly. So thank you very much. So yes, we're going to talk about a little bit about Ingenico does, but also the great work we've done together with Accenture at Ingenico. So what do we do? So basically, we're not so very well known in the Netherlands, because in the Netherlands, if you go to a store, you very often see different kind of terminals. But what we do is basically we build payment terminals. And so when you go to a restaurant, you want to pay, and the nice lady comes where you want to pay, and she comes with a credit card, then the terminals, we build them. But we also build the in-store software, and I think a very strategic element of what we do is we build the online payments. So for many customers, where you go online, if you go to AliExpress, if you go to Blizzard, if you go to EA Games, when you pay on the internet site and you click on pay, you end up with our systems. So what is it that we do? So let's take a customer, a very important one of us, called Blizzard. They recently launched Destiny 2 last week, so there was a big campaign around Destiny 2. So what do? Well, they build software, they build games, right? So they're very much big in the gaming industry, and they are professionals, and they want to focus themselves on building games. In this case, for example, Destiny 2 or World of Warcraft, whatever they want to do. What they don't want to be, a payment expert. Yeah? What they also want to do is they want to sell the game across the globe. So for example, they started off in the US, and you start selling your game in US dollars to the US market. It's very nice. But then at some point in time, you want to sell your game in the Netherlands, very small country in the world, and these people want to pay with Ideal. You have no clue what Ideal is, but okay, so you're in the country, but you still want to offer Ideal. Then when your business starts growing, you also want to sell Destiny 2 in Indonesia, where the people want to pay with some kind of exotic payment method in Indonesia, and they want to pay in Indonesian rupees. Then you go to Brazil, and there they want to pay in cash with boletos. So in the end, you want to sell in 150 countries, and you want to sell with 150 payment methods. Well, you don't want to organize all this kind of stuff. You don't want to build companies in the countries. You don't want to have a bank account in the countries. So basically what Blizzard does, they integrate into us, into Ingenico, and we arrange all the payments with the payment methods and collecting the money in the different currencies and just giving them the money. So that's, on a very high level, what we do in Ingenico. So basically we simplify the interface to the customer, in this case Blizzard, but it means we have a very complex ecosystem behind that. So what is our strategy? So as a company, we've been growing 10% year after year. So how do we do that? We do that by buying other companies. So we started off as Ingenico, doing terminals. Then we found out maybe online payments is more strategic. So we bought Ogone, we bought EasyCash, we bought Global Collect, we bought Subuno, we bought TechProcess. So we buy companies all the time. I'm saying this, it's not a very technical thing to say, but it just creates a very difficult environment to do techie stuff in. So we have multiple technologies, as you can imagine. We have duplicate technologies. We have the same people doing the same thing. So that gives us a challenge. While doing that, another big challenge that we have is that when we buy a company, people are afraid of their jobs, so they run away, and we don't want people to run away. And if I look at what we've been doing for quite some time now, the biggest challenge we have as a company is something we call the not invented here syndrome. And that's very, when you're technical, something that happens to you, because basically it means that if you didn't develop it yourself, it can never be good. So your own code, your own thing you've developed can only be good. And if you want to cooperate between companies, that's fairly difficult. So then we were saying, okay, so how do we become successful? How do we get to this, you know, delivery of code into production in one day? So instead of, you know, inventing the wheel ourselves, we started looking at different different companies and said, okay, how did they fix certain elements of what we tried to do? So we looked at Spotify from the organizational part. So I will talk a little bit about that. We've organized over there. Then we talked at architecture level with Netflix. And also very important for us is the continuous integration, continuous delivery, yeah, to basically every day be able to publish new features for our customers in production. Gabriel will talk about Netflix and Facebook, and I will do a little bit talking about Spotify, so what we do. So our traditional organization, if you look at where we are, we had you, the developer, and then we had business analysts, IT business analysts, project managers, business architects, me. I'm still there, by the way. We removed all the others. Yeah, so lots of people around the poor guy, you know, trying to do the work. So while moving to the Spotify organization, or inspired by Spotify organization, we basically started adding more and more developers to what we tried to do. We started reducing all the overhead, like business analysts, IT business analysts, business architects, project managers, myself, well, I'm still there. But so we started doing that. We started centralizing. We started developing around the organization, around the developer, basically also implementing servant leadership for me as well. So what can I do to optimize the work for the people, for the technology people? Well, I've been working on that, and that's where we use the Spotify organization with the nice naming of squads and tribes, and also across different companies, we set up tribes and squads to really, you know, foster the cooperation. So now I'm going to move to Gabriel.
Yes. Now, so I think one of the items that Roy mentioned as well around the Spotify model, one thing we really changed as well is was in really, instead of looking from a technical point of view, we have multiple technical applications, really looking at it from a product point of view. So really looking at value teams. So for example, we had, in the past, we had just one called big application called Payment Engine. Well, I think it was even differently called. But it looked a little bit like this. So I'm not sure if you can see it in the back, but this is a data center. It's not our data center, but it's close now. So all the lines that you see, all the threads, is really showing a little bit how our application looked like. It was really almost like a mainframe system. And maybe from the old Java people, this was really Java 1.0. And Roy mentioned not invented here syndrome. They built their own application server. So that's where all the threads come in, right? All the threads are running parallel. So we can only see what is happening with the application itself, runtime. We can only see what was particularly in memory, et cetera, et cetera. So that was really what was happening. And to think about this company is using huge amounts of flow. So I think it's 11th of November, Chinese single day. For example, Alibaba does around $18 billion in one day. So 18 billion. Guess what? We are handling payments for them. Not all of them, of course, but a huge bulk. So there's tremendous amounts of flow going into the system. And in the past, we had one system and just one big machine. Well, we had multiple big machines, but a customer could only end up on one machine. So you can imagine Alibaba opens the floods. What will happen? It overflows because one machine can't handle so much flow. It goes to the next, so it shuts down, goes to the next machine, shuts down, and suddenly our whole platform is gone. So you can imagine what kind of implications this has from an architecture point of view. But I'm not here to talk, well, a little bit to talk about the history, but a little bit how you guys can, because I think a lot of you are struggling with it, how you can come from these big monolithic legacy systems to the real cool stuff, right? We saw the Netflix, and probably all of you know, right, Netflix, microservices, all the cool terms that everybody's using is, but how do you really, in practice, can move to that? So I'm going to explain a little bit how we've done it. So in the left side, we had this big, let's say, legacy application a few years ago, and you can already see a lot. You have caching logic, threading logic, etc., application server logic as well, and business logic. But what we thought about, okay, what we should do is build like all the cool guys do, the Googles do, etc., build a very slick and mean architecture. So we decided, okay, let's do the microservice approach, but let's start with at least one functionality. So really looking at from a functionality perspective. And the first one we did was called get order status, because for some reason all our customers want to know what the status of the order is, if they paid yes or no, right? And so we moved that and tested that on production. And when we moved, and that was, I think, in the beginning, I think that one went really fast, a few months probably, just to test if our new platform would work. At the time, we were still, we moved to a real application server, at the time Oracle. We now moved already more to Spring Boot and that kind of technologies. But at this time, we had just moving to an application server. So we had it on production, and then slowly we did canary releasing. So we put it on production and slowly moved flow from our main system to this new framework and see to test it. And we saw the results were very well. However, it is not the end all, because this is easy, right? It comes when you start refactoring. And we used an approach called the Strangler pattern. I think Fowler also wrote an article around it. It's really about the Strangler tree. And the Strangler tree is a tree that exists on the existing tree. It builds upon it and slowly kills the existing one and grows itself. And that's a little bit what we've done here as well. So we slowly looked at the previous one and we grow our own tree for that. But to be honest, we grow a complete forest now. It's not a big application anymore. We really created small microservices everywhere. And we discussed a little bit in the beginning with the Spotify model for our product teams, right? It's really on product base. Well, guess what? Our microservices are also now product-based. For example, PayPal. PayPal is a payment method that you have on the site that's very different than anything else. So we have a real more dedicated team related to that. Same for fraud. So we're not looking at for how many systems are behind it. In the past, it was just one. But there are now, of course, multiple microservices behind it. But we're really looking at from what kind of value can we deliver to our clients and really build the team around it. And everybody talks about, yeah, we have the business people in the teams, etc. For us, it is really the business people, and now I think even the sales people are involved in that team. So it's really an end-to-end team. And everybody says, well, Scrum should only have a two pizza team, etc. But if you look at that perspective, they are a little bit bigger. But it works quite well because you deliver end value to our customers. And now that we made this difference, it really speeds up our whole delivery process. Make sense? Or are you all asleep? Okay, they're still there. Phew. So, but then of course it's a little bit, okay, what kind of cool stuff can you do? If you have the microservice, everybody's talking about it. And this is what I want to see. This is an ongoing experiment that we did right in the beginning to show it a little bit. If we look here, is the number of transactions per second that we throw into the system. So what we do, we have multiple machines, and there's just one single machine on the Amazon cloud that is just getting all the flow. So we are reproducing, let's say, Chinese single day, as much flow as you can, just on one simple machine. And as you can see here, it goes quite well with 300 transactions per second. And this is on our test environment, of course, at the time. And we are here around 1,000 transactions per second. The machine was getting a little bit sweaty, let's call it that way. It's getting into troubles, right? And now fully automatically, because in the past we needed to, you cannot look at what a particular company is doing. For example, if Blizzard announces in BlizzCon, I think it's this weekend even, a new game and just sends it out there, and suddenly you get huge amounts of flow. So we can't anticipate always what the customers are doing. And this one, we automatically do that because it's alarm triggered. Hey, it's the most performance that we have. It starts up a new instance, and eventually you can see here, out of nothing, without any manual intervention, we're able to handle 2,000 transactions per second just because we added the machine. And that's really where you eventually want to go to. And that's coming from where we were, that we were probably sweating if there was too much flow on one machine, we can now automatically scale. And that's really what we do with a lot of these experiments. And we started with experimentation, and now we are really implementing this on a production system. And if you then look at it, what Roy already mentioned in the beginning, there's a lot, the architecture big part, but I think a real big part of our environment is really about the delivery. So if we talk about delivery, this was a little bit what was happening. So our, let's say, train that goes to production was, I think, less than 5 times a year. And Roy, as CTO, was involved in that release. So really the whole company was trying to get something to production of this big platform. And Yeah, as you can see, if everybody's involved, but everyone wants to have, if you're only going a train 5 times a year, everybody wants to go into that train, right? What happens then, as you can see here in the back as well, people fall off and all kinds of things. The train is going very slowly. That's something you don't want to. So we changed that a lot. And eventually what we did, we decoupled the releases and the deployment. So that means that when we put something on production, it's almost the same system as previously, but we are releasing functionality to our customers a lot more slowly. So instead of deploying it, it's the same version, but the code is already there. It's sleeping. So with feature toggles, we enable it to put it on production. And that way we can do it on particular countries, we can do it on particular clients, and that way we are, because this system needs to be stable. To be honest, if this system goes down, then tonight, for example, it could be you can't buy your pizza online or that kind of thing. So it has huge amounts of impact. So we slowly introduce those items. We went to automatic continuous integration, continuous delivery. We'll show you some slides as well. Daily production. So we had a vision that I was responsible for at the time, is to go from in the morning code commit, in the afternoon to production. And this is a payment industry company. So you could imagine what kind of regulation. Officially, we're also a bank, I think. Yep. So our regulations of a bank we have, but also what we call PCI compliancy. So there's a lot of regulation to be able to do that. So we really had quite, at the time, a far vision. But if you look at it, the whole system it was in the past, we are now releasing daily to production. And yeah, we have probably one of the biggest credit card databases in the world. So you could imagine how much a regulation around this. But we found out how more you automate, how more a regulation process goes easier. Because there's not a lot, yeah, normally we need to figure out all kinds of documentation, log files, etc. Now we just point them, there's the stuff, good luck with it. 99.59 uptime, yeah, of course, cannot go down. In the past, it really took weeks to deploy something to production. Now it's less than an hour. So we can really push a button and we fully automated everything. Containerized, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, ready in 1 to 2 days. So this is a little bit, when I got this message, it's from, I got one of our DevOps engineers. I got a message. I was at a DevOps conference presenting together with Ingenico as well. We were there and I got an email from, hey, this is the wet dream of every developer. Like, okay. What is this? And he showed me just a pipeline that we finally had a full automated stack without, well, we have one human intervention from code commit to production, and that human intervention is the approval. So we have now, and I've showed here a little bit, I moved a little bit to testing because we have like 30,000 automatic regression test set that we run in a few minutes. So there's huge amount of flow that we are running through the system. But it gives you also a little bit of the numbers that we do. So we are now able to deploy, for example, on a test environment within 5 minutes. And if you look at the production environment, we can even do it also around 5 to 3 minutes from one service. Because we can deliver so much faster, we see that also our business model is almost changing. Because we were having the discussion last week, and said for the first time I see some of the business people with some of, not having a lot of sleep that night. And normally they don't care, but now they're really so much embedded in a team that they are almost, I don't want to say they're starting developing, because probably we don't want to have that, but they're really involved in the team. And I think that is overall the biggest win. So if we then look at a little bit from what is our technology stack, yeah, I think probably you know all of them, but it's really a Java stack that we originally have. We are now looking at some other technologies as well. We are, to be honest, I'm not sure if there's a lot of Oracle people in the room, but we're trying to get a little bit less of Oracle, expensive. But really focus on Spring Boot, that kind of things. We have, of course, Git, quite interesting to know as well. We really do mainline development. In the past, we really had feature branches, but to be able to deliver, let's say, every hour or constantly to production, we have removed the complete feature branching. Really have one mainline branch that as soon as you commit your code, it goes to production. And that's really our approach that we changed during during development to be able to really deliver faster to production. But that means also there's a lot more stress on the automated testing, because you need to make sure when you push something to production that you are able to do it without any issues. Because if it goes down, then it's probably my hat as well and Roy's hat as well, because it's really so, so important. But then I think eventually it's really about what are the results, right? I showed you a lot of, about the items that we do and how we've done it, but I think, Roy, you would be probably the best guy to explain a little bit what are the, eventually the results.
Yep, thank you. So I think from a company's perspective, what you're aiming for is, of course, to get as much output as possible, right? So what we've seen, if you look at quarter 2015, first quarter, to now 2017, I think we have, you know, increased where we had like 5 features coming out in 2015. I think now we have, you know, what is it, more than 75. So I think it's like times, many times, yeah? So it's really improved. So the output of the development teams has significantly increased, which basically means that all the money that we invest in the teams, also some value comes out. And that's really, really a dramatic improvement over there. Then I think, as you can imagine, from our perspective, platform stability is the number one priority. You can imagine, take Blizzard, and you're in the middle of your Destiny 2 campaign, and your customers cannot make payments anymore because our platform is down. I can tell you, I will get an immediate call from the CTO, who will probably start really shouting at me that, you know, they wanna sell their game and their customers are not able to pay. So you can imagine that availability is the most important part for our platforms. What we have also done while implementing all the stuff that Gabriel was talking about, we've also really reduced the number of incidents and we've significantly improved the uptime. I think last year we had 125 seconds downtime. And so that's really, so that's 5 nines availability. People always talk about it, but it's very difficult to achieve, but we're there.
It's quite interesting that the one time what it was read that we had a P1 incident was a few hours before Alibaba started. So that was quite.
That was not really fun.
Yeah. So but eventually, it was a good thing because everybody was there and we were able to fix it just.
Yeah, I didn't think it was a good thing.
Yeah, not for, for you.
Seriously, no. It was before the. I think 2 hours before Alibaba show.
2 hours. Yeah.
Yeah, 2 hours before they kick off their campaign. So you can imagine Alibaba does 175,000 transactions per second. Not with us, but domestically in China. So they do 175,000 payments per second in China, and then they have some international ones with us, but also with 10 others. So it's massive, and so they just test everything, and everything has to be done. And then, you know, our system broke down for 125 seconds, but you had to switch flow, all kind of stuff. Well, next time we'll do that another day.
Yeah. Yeah.
coming back to best practices, I said, we work agile, fully agile, inspired by Spotify. We only work on things that add value. So we cut out all the overhead, all the other stuff. We cut out as many managers as possible. We always finish what we start, especially in high volatile work. You know, you start things, oh, let's do that. And in the end, you don't deliver anything. And we automate everything. And that really helps us a lot. And it really helps us in the throughput. And also very important, we're very transparent in what we do. Also towards senior management, we say, well, we have so many people working on this, and it also creates some peace and quiet, and also shows very nicely what we've been doing.
Yeah, and I think
thank
as
you.
Well.
I think we're done.
Yeah, we're done? Yeah. Okay, cool.
At least the ladies said done.
But I think overall, transparent is also for your companies as well. We are here together with Ingenico, and I think that's really about transparency. It's both to the vendors, both to the customers. It's really about transparency, I think, and the people. But let's go, because else the thing will come and we'll get off.
Good.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks.